All right, what is up, you guys and fellow Queen fans, music fans, all out there, who've been keep coming back to the channel. Much respect, much love, and for you guys, delivering another one from Hammersmith Odeon. Again, we just went over the medley. Now we're looking at Brighton Rock, and this is one I do not think was on the set from Live at the Rainbow. So figured might as well see this one live. Yeah, and I also combined son and daughter too right afterwards. So very excited to hear that combination, hear that one again. But yeah, let's get right into it. Let's go.
Then, we're now going to feature Brian May on guitar. And this number is entitled Brighton Rock.
Ooh. Right away, it's a very skippy kind of almost, I wouldn't say thrashy, but just a very late 80s type of feel, you know? If that makes sense. But yeah, clearly it's a very racy tone. If that make you know that it's a very racy tone, a lot of just kind of like a flamethrower, you know what I mean? That's the kind of tone that he's got, especially with those double stops, those skippy galloping bass licks and that riff. And I love how they pause with the words, right? Like they don't just say magic in the air, they say magic in the air, and they just chop up the words like that to go right along with the chord changes, and it makes it sound very very powerful. And this is a very upbeat song. I wasn't expecting it to sound like this, but yeah, really great. Also, really, the bass is also dominating the mix too, is from what I've noticed. Aside from the little pauses between the verses, the bass comes through nice and heavy. Yep, playing the upstrokes. Whew. Oh, I just gotta play that again. It looks like he's about to enter a solo too, by the way. I like that a lot of these early records from the Rainbow set and everything. A lot of their songs are kind of like they have these before diving in. It's like a different section of the song. They always play like the instrumental section just based on two chords, just a da-na, da-da, stuff like that, letting it ring out like it is now. But he just played a really cool descending little riff, almost sound like Black Sabbath, something very evil sounding. I don't know if this is, I don't think he's playing power chords, but whatever he just played, I'll point it out when it gets there, but it sounded pretty badass. Right there, might be power chord, I don't know. Woo! In the bass too. Yeah, rhythm. Ooh, some heavy delay going on, it looks like, right now. Okay, so far, half lightning fast blues licks, man, really fast. There's some Clapton-y sounding, like, double stop things going on there at the end, which is pretty nice. I love the rhythm effect of the palm muting, alternating palm muting with the vibratos and the fast licks, and back into, like, the quick descending patterns and ascending patterns, really tight hammer-ons and pull-offs mixed in there. I love the sound. It's like a muddy, I wouldn't say a muddy sound, but it's like a, I would say muddy. It's like a muddy, but very rhythmic, very rhythmically intense, you know, it's very engaging. And the tone is wicked. The vibratos are absolutely amazing. The bends that he's hitting, perfect for this. And I think the tone carried over from the verse to this one, which is why the bass was allowed to dominate sort of the mix and the verses and stuff. But I think now is when the tone really shines through. That sounds cool. Woo! That's like a Clapton type of band. Early Queen. Look at that shot. That's a perfect shot. It's kind of eerie. It's like a ghostly sound. The delay had so much. Very risky choice, but he pays off. Absolutely pays off. It has a very spacey sound, like very like almost trippy, you know what I mean? I mean, this solo has everything. Blues, has the metal, really fast galloping, double stops, a lot of ascending, descending. That's kind of the theme, ascending up the scale, back down the scale. And then some cool little themes, like theme music. Now, I wonder if that's from a section, like when he's playing those single notes on the I don't know if that was from like a theme from somewhere, but it sounded like it. You know, it sounds really cool. Just changed the whole style up right there. And now this section just really, it's just beautiful. This is the theme. That's what I'm about. Back to the blues again, yep. Ah, really digging into it. Oh, here we go. Oh, so that was Son and Daughter. Maybe those riffs were from that song. Okay, I gotta refresh my memory, I guess, but wow, that was... I love the solos where they kind of throw in like a classical, not, this wasn't really classical, but like a more, like I said, it's a maybe a hard rocking solo or a fast blues type of solo. Kind of like Heartbreaker, but Jimmy Page. Let's make that comparison, right? I forgot which version it was. It's on my channel, but there's some versions where he just plays that a little bluesy blues tune where he turns into the clean sound, and then he plays Bach, and then just changes the whole mood of the solo. But the same thing's done here, but like it's just more expansive, like it's not just he throws it in there and it's just there to be there, right? It's not just kind of showing up, oh, it's I can do this, but he takes it to a whole new direction. And it's actually It's actually, that was phenomenal. I mean, that might be one of the best solos I've ever seen. Seriously, like, I mean, the delay adds a whole new ethereal effect to it. Really, his sense of contrast is very nice too. The subtle palm mutes, really digging in and biting into some of those notes, really raking across all the strings. Muting technique's phenomenal here, by the way. And just really descending, use of scales, really tasty notes in the scale that he uses to switch things up. Subtle changes to make it sound like a whole different mood. You know, a lot of it's based on the bluesy sound, just general pentatonic, I'm assuming, or minor, natural minor, or the minor scale. But yeah, switching it up. There's definitely some added note that's definitely worth for me looking into how he made this sound, especially when he changed into those that little theme I was talking about, where it started to get really spacey before that whole mellow instrumental, like with the delay and stuff that I paused at, but right before that part where he started using that new theme into the solo. But yeah, I mean, metal wise, that's there. Metalheads would love this because this is a lot of galloping, chugging, not really chugging, but galloping fast licks, kind of like in early Metallica, even like Hit the Lights off Kill 'Em All. Even Search and Destroy had similar type of double stop licks here and there, really racy sound. But yeah, this tone is just out of this world. But as far as the actual Brighton Rock, I know the solo kind of stole the spotlight a bit, but beginning, it sounded like a solid song, you know. Not really what I was expecting it to be about. It's kind of being on a holiday in Brighton, you know, meeting, you know, just having a good time, not, you know, meeting somebody, whatever, on a holiday, and just kind of a party, go crazy kind of song. Which is pretty cool. But that pre-chorus though, I mean, that chorus right after was like right here was a great, I remember that. Right here. That chord change right there, what is the moonshine? All is green and still. All any moonshine down. A little people magic, if you will. Yeah, I mean, and of course, a lot of rhythmically very sound. Just the whole, even the solo's got a whole groove to it, everything. I mean, it's just great. Everything about this is great. But yeah, approaching 20 minutes. Don't want to take this too long, but Sandman, it's the Sandman. Checking out. Peace.